Hello, sir. Thank you so much for joining us in this live session.
Hi.
Hi, sir. How are you?
What's clear?
Yeah,
Good.
everything is clear. How are you doing today?
Good, good.
Good. Thank you so much for coming here. I'm really excited to be a part of this conversation with you. I guess we all have idols in our lives who are such a powerhouse. They inspire us with their immense creativity, with their guidance on how things work in this profession. And I guess I'm saying this on behalf of everyone who is joining us here today, that you are an idol for all of us. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Nice
Yeah.
to meet you.
So actually, when I posted about this Instagram live session, I was flooded with questions about your work ethics and your design style. And what I've observed so far from those questions is that people derive inspiration from you on an everyday basis. And since now that you have started uploading all these videos on these topics that help budding architects and designers, so that is something that people really need to hear. And because as you said in your yesterday's video that your work life is not always perfect. There will be some kind of hurdles or failures. But the important thing is to learn from them and take those baby steps, celebrate those baby steps, and keep moving forward with it. So that was a really great video, and I guess all of us needed to hear that.
Yeah, but that's absolutely cool. This profession is like that because we guys are all driven by this passion
Yeah.
and we are dying to do this thing. If somebody gives you half a
Yeah.
chance to do it, you go all out and you go crazy and you want to do something new and you spend all the time and effort, and then so many times it does not happen. It could be because of client, it could be because of finance, it could be because of something wrong with the. I mean, today.
Absolutely. Huh. There are lots of disputes on land ownerships, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So you started practicing in 1992. A lot of us were not even born by that time, and you've come such a long way. So people are saying that they can't hear you properly. There's some problem with the internet, I guess.
Yeah, maybe. So
Yeah,
I'll try
I
speaking
can
louder.
hear you. No, it's the problem with the
Okay.
internet, not with your voice. It's some internet glitch. It's hanging a little bit in the middle. So as I was saying that you started practicing in 1992, and a lot of us were not even born by that time, and you've come such a long way from an architect to the Sanjay Puri architects. People now look at you as a brand architect of this country. So how would you summarize your journey, and how would you suggest budding architects and designers start their journey in this profession?
So you can't summarize the entire thing, but I'll tell you the
Absolutely, yeah.
best thing and the most important thing is experience. So I still remember I was in second year, so I started working with a piece contractor at the age of 18. So I was already working before I went into college. I continued through all 5 years. Everybody would come and ask these questions in college, like, "Are you crazy? You're a student, and this is the time to focus on learning and not, get bogged down by the real world and reality." So I would just listen to them and laugh it off, because end of the day, the real experience is the real experience. And when you're doing something that is real and you're doing something that is hypothetical together in college, the two of them both really, really work well together, because you've got that experience. So you actually know when you're designing that this is not going to be able to get built. So might as well do something that is possible to be built, right? So in that sense, your project does not become so hypothetical, it becomes more realistic. And because you've seen so much, you are better informed. That's a very important thing. And then along with all this, in second year, a cousin of mine had come home, and somebody once in a while you meet who's genuinely interested in what you're doing. So she said, "Come on, come on, show me all your work. What are you doing in college?" So I showed her, and at that point, we were doing some interior design presentation, you know. So she said, wow, look at this. It's like this yellow toilet that you made is very nice, very colorful and all. So she asked me, can you do something in reality? I said, it means? She said, no, if I have, just a toilet to be done, would you be able to do it and execute it? I said, yeah, of course. So that's one more point that, you know, when you have the experience, you can always say yes because you actually know how to do it. You're not taking this chance. So he went and did that, and that led to meeting the painting contractor of that toilet, the guy who did the civil work as well as the painting. 1 month later, called me and said, you know, I have this client who wants to do something in Gujarat. Will you do it? So I said, of course, I'll do it. It was a principal's office. And from that principal's office, we ended up doing the computer lab there, a new civil engineering building, and so many other things. So in second year, you are doing college, you're working full time, and the only break that you get from Saturday night to Monday morning was spent going to Nadiad in Gujarat, where this project was, in an overnight train, working there, coming back by the overnight train, back in time for college at 7:30 in the morning. It's all of these three things put together. So the real-time experience, the experience of working in an office, as well as the experience of architecture in school. And today I find that people are not doing the real experience. They're just doing that 6 month internship for the sake of it. Yes, there are a few people who are... as much of it as possible physically, because that's the only thing that helps. The more you see and the more you've physically seen and the more you've actually gone through is what is going to help you in life.
Absolutely. So in the first few years when you started practicing since 1992, you have dealt with a lot of real estate developers and builders. And one of the major hurdles of working with these clients is that we are more focused on context of the site or the end user who is going to actually use that space. And they are more focused on the return on investment. And it becomes really hard to actually convey that idea to them that why certain things have to be a certain way. So what is your take on this?
So to be realistic, you explain to them that, you know, it's not just about ROI. You will get the ROI, but if you do something better, it helps people in the long run. And finally, you are also building a reputation, right? This is not going to be your own first project. You're going to build 30, 40, 50 more projects. So in every one project that you do well is going to, you know, last a lifetime in terms of the goodwill of people. And then there are people who understand it. So it's not everybody who just wants to count money and count square footage.
All right. So I guess this problem is not just limited to real estate people. This is also with other clients. Even in small scale projects, like residential projects that budding architects, your budding practitioners get to do. So what clients are generally doing right now is that they go to the internet, they do their research, then they get confused, and then they come to the architect saying, ki hame tujhe aisa bana ke de do. And when we give our design proposal to them, they will either not accept it or they will ask for a glass ka dabba, you know, glass wrap around, and that whole space will feel like an oven. So how can budding architects and designers educate clients on what is good for them in the long term basis for their own houses or their own sites?
So I think the net is really bad, huh?
Yeah, voice there's something still wrong with the internet. Yeah, no, for a lot of people, the voice is not coming and your picture hang, basically. Okay. Yeah, I can hear you properly. I think people cannot hear you.
Somebody is asking, can you repeat the question of how to convince a client? See, it all depends on the client. It all depends on the client. Like I was saying, you have to explain it to them in their way. Explain to them that their building will become like a heat trap. It will be, it will not be energy efficient.
Right, absolutely. So when we talk about creating designs, design proposals, when we talk about creating concepts, one of the most popular questions that I have had so far is how to create a concept. And I always say that there is no definite way to create a concept, right? So one thing that we can start with is by understanding the context of the site first and then start developing concepts out of it. So when we specifically talk about medium to large scale projects, what are some important factors that should be considered while, understanding the context of the site?
So when you have a site, the very most important thing is, A, you understand what the client's requirement.
All right, yeah. So we have been in this pandemic situation for a few weeks now, and one of the major worries that I have seen everybody worrying about, whether it's a student, employee, or entrepreneur, is that how is it this going to affect me? And even I created an Instagram Live a week back on how people can use this time to self-assess, do a SWOT analysis of themselves, and analyze and improvise and learn new skills. Like, you created this amazing video on sketching and how architects and designers can easily put their concepts, what they have in their head, on paper by sketching. So what do you think are some essential skills that people can learn online, which will help them in the near future? And how is this pandemic situation going to affect us in this year? Even I can't hear you.
Something.
Your screen is hanged, so it's completely on hang mode.
Clients who were not willing to have this webinar kind of meeting.
We can try that. I will just end this live session and then I'll request you again to come over. Because the problem is there's some glitch in the internet. Otherwise, your voice is audible, but it's coming really late and maybe there is break in between the voice.
Yeah, so the same thing is happening with yours also. It's the same thing happening.
So that's what they're saying, that the voice is not audible.
Yeah, I think there's too much internet traffic. Because everybody is only using the internet, right?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
So I guess there's no choice to this. Still no audio.
So should I restart? Should I just go live again and then restart?
Yeah, start it again. Let's see if it makes a difference. Start it again.
Absolutely.
Let's see
if it makes a difference. I'll restart. Okay.
Okay, let's see.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's better. Is it better? Is anybody speaking? Can you hear?
People are saying hello, bhai. I don't know where is this. Yes, yes, you are audible now. Yes. Even yes. I can hear you clearly now. I guess there was the internet. Yes. All right. So where should we start with the previous question only on this pandemic situation, or should I get back to the next question? We were talking about the pandemic situation as to what skills that people can learn while from the comfort of their home and how the situation is going to affect us in the near future.
Right. So, you know, right now is the time that there are a lot of webinars going on in the design field, at least, even in other fields. So it's a good time to catch up, to get, you know, more educated on so many aspects. I've been reading there was something going on lighting. There was something going on interior design, on some color scheming. There are so many of these live chats going on that it'll be great to connect to them so that you can, you know, expand your knowledge, number one. So, plus, of course, if there is something that you always wanted to do, like improve on your sketching skills, now's the time to do it. Yeah. What I see happening post this coming back to normal, what's going to happen is it's going to take a long time for things to actually come back to normal. Because the entire construction industry, the interior design, all of it is dependent on a lot of workers. All these workers have suffered a huge amount trying to get back to their homes, being stranded at the borders. I mean, it's been a really terrible time for them. So it's going to take a long time for them to come back and that situation to happen again, where work can really restart all over again, because obviously every single project across the country has stopped. And so is it in the other parts of the world. And the problem is the same everywhere else also. Even in the US, there are migrant workers who've gone back or trying to go back. So it's going to take a long while for things to bounce back and come back. But what we learn from this, I had said earlier also, that now when you do a construction site, it must be mandatory, at least in the larger sites, that you provide proper workers housing there. There should be a cafeteria, there should be a medical room, and there should be proper sleeping and seating arrangements made for them, so that henceforth, if any of this happens, it should never happen like this, that, you know, the workers who are coming here for their livelihood and their daily wages, people are, you know, stuck in a situation like this where they don't have food, water, shelter, none of it. So that's one very important aspect. What has also happened during this COVID period is that clients who up till now were not willing to do a virtual conference because, you know, everybody said, no, we need to meet. You know, we physically need to meet, whether you're sitting in Delhi or Calcutta. No. You come for one day, come for 3 hours, come for 4 hours. But now all of those people, since they did not have a choice, have come to virtual conferencing. And because they come to virtual conferencing, you found that, okay, hey, this works. You know, so what I see in the future is that offices, homes, even housing societies will have large conferencing facilities to be able to facilitate such things and have internet with higher speed, so that it makes life really easy to be able to communicate virtually. And by doing so, what will happen is the number of meetings for anything will go down. Even sites will be connected with conferencing facilities, so that when a project manager on a site wants to ask you something, it's very easy. Cameras pointed in that direction. He shows you what is going on and he checks with you, or he opens up a drawing there. And today with, you know, HP's new technology and virtual reality, with the advances that are made, you can actually physically walk in each part and identify a problem and do it. But everybody was scared to do this, right? But now, because this was the only solution, now people will be open to doing this. So I see meetings going down, real meetings, physical meetings, which means less cars on the road, less flights, less carbon footprint, and a much more comfortable way, because you're not spending so much time, right? Let's say, I mean, simply to go from Bombay to Delhi, you got to wake up 2.5 hours before the flight, go there 3 hours, get there 2 hours flight. So it's like you wasted about 8-10 hours for a 2-3 hour meeting or a 2-3 hour site meeting. So now all those 10 hours can be used for constructive purposes, right? So imagine the time saving. That's huge. So the work on output increases and simultaneously the carbon footprint reduces. So there is a lot of good that is going to happen also. Although it's going to take a long time, the economy is going to take a long time to come back.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So the Architects Challenge webinar that happened today morning, I attended that webinar and it had some interesting insights on how the profession is going to look like in the future. So can you enlighten us on what measures Council of Architecture is taking to protect and to spread awareness about our profession? Like he was talking about introducing architecture in 11th and 12th grade as well. So what all is the Council of Architecture planning to do for the benefit of this profession?
Okay, so that's a long answer, but I can tell you in short. What is happening is the act was made in 1972. So it's 50 years old now. And at that time, there was a definition of an architect. That definition has changed vastly. So whatever this Supreme Court ruling is the ruling is actually similar to what it was long back. It still does not allow a person to call themselves an architect unless you're actually registered with the Council of Architecture. So that's a good point. The minus point is only that they're saying that somebody else can also practice. But what the Council of Architecture is now going to do is redefine that whole architectural definition. So what an architect embodies and what an architect's duties actually are, because finally, so there was a time when architects were doing everything. The architect was doing the lighting, they were doing the landscape, they were doing the acoustics, some of them were doing the structure as well, because all of us architects have been taught structure for 3 years in college, right? So we are also capable of doing it. So there was that time. But now there are specialists for each thing. But at the same time, number of thousands and thousands, I mean, everybody is living in a building. Today, a building, if it collapses, what happens? So you have to have somebody qualified. So there has to be one person who takes the onus of it all. So that person is still going to be the architect. So these definitions are going to be redefined. Yes, they are trying to include like a short course so that people are more aware of architecture. But what we also need to do is to make the public aware of what is architecture. In the last 10 years, it has happened, but we need to increase that awareness because, you know, like you said, clients are coming and saying, you know, make a glass box for me. I don't want to do this. They're picking up something from the internet and saying, you know, make me this when that's not relevant to you. It's not relevant to the climate. It's not relevant to your function. I mean, I have faced it and I keep facing it even now all the time. Okay. So it's not that once you've had a certain number of years, you know, you're going to go past it. And now when somebody comes to you, they'll say, hey, okay, whatever you said is fine. With every client, let me tell you that we still have to argue. We have to argue from day one till day end, till the project is finished. Our clients are constantly trying to change designs also, constantly trying to influence the design halfway through the project also. So it's a constant fight. I mean, that is bound to be. So the thing is, let's make the public in general aware of what good architecture is. Then people will not come and ask you these, you know, things which do not make sense.
Yeah,
so for that awareness, you need media. You need a lot more architectural portals which convey this message all through. And this is already happening. To an extent, it's happening. It's happening way more than it was happening 10 years back, right? I mean, today there are a lot of people probably on this chat also who are not related to the architecture field who are watching it. And they are understanding. So it's a good thing. And we keep increasing.
A common man basically doesn't know what an architect, who an architect is and what a good architecture really means. They know who a doctor is, they know who a CA is, and people don't argue with a doctor ki mujhe medicine khani, mujhe medicine nahi khani. They don't argue with CAs that, you know, don't file my ITR like this or like that. But for architects, it's not like that. It's like they want to contact you to get something built according to their, what they have in mind, and not what is the best option for them.
Yeah, and you know, we actually need media participation for this because have you ever read the FT Weekend? FT Weekend is an amazing paper. Every time you have the FT Weekend comes with three supplements on every weekend. So one entire supplement is called design. And it's got, they'll pick up an architectural project or there'll be an interview with an architect. There will be an artist. There will be something about culture, dance, all of that. So it's like a 15, 20, 18 page booklet on design every weekend. Okay, forget this. Go to Netherlands. You know, Netherlands is such a design conscious country that on a daily basis, if you pick up the paper, there will be some, you know, design related article. But what is it in India? There's no design related article. Once in a while, in a weekend, there may be one small thing, you know, tips how to do your home or how to improve your office. But it's not enough. So
that's DIY.
media, hopefully some media people will hear this. It's that the media needs to take this forward to create awareness amongst people in general about what the design is.
Advertise on what architecture really is.
That whole thing about how good design is good business.
Because you're saving energy.
You're doing so many things.
You're
reducing the carbon footprint. So many things.
So many things. And now people are also slowly and steadily getting aware of how much they're harming the planet. So this is also something that should be spread awareness for in terms of architecture as well, that how what we do is something really different and what we do has a great impact on planet as well. So that is also something that media needs to cover, is why architects are important. So should we, people are asking about this client question, to repeat the client question, should I just quickly repeat a couple of questions that we discussed before? Yeah, that sure. People couldn't hear. So one of the questions was that in terms of small scale projects, people do their research and people get confused and come to the architect saying ki hame to yehi bana do, hame aisa ghar bana do simply, and or they come with the idea in their head of a glass box. So how do beginning architects and designers work with such kind of clients and make them understand why a glass box is not suitable to as per the context of their site?
So like I told you, you know, it's not just small client, small architect or young architect or whatever it is. This is happening to us even now.
Okay.
As late as 3 weeks ago, somebody called up from Hyderabad, said, you know, we did this, you saw this concrete house that you made in Rajasthan, is beautiful. And I want to make a 20,000 square feet house in Hyderabad. So he said, wow, 20,000 square feet house is like a good project here. So I said, okay, you send me your requirements and stuff. So along with the requirements, he sent me two photographs of a colonial house. You know, a typical colonial house, which exists in so many parts of the world, actually. So I said, you know, you saw a particular kind of house. It was abstract. It was in exposed concrete. And you are asking me that, I mean, why you send me this photograph? He said, no, but that's the way I want my house. I said, but that's not the way, you know, you should be doing your house. He said, but why not? This is what I like. So... It's very difficult to explain to some people, and this happens to us even now. So it is going to happen all your life. Okay, it's not in the beginning and on the end. It's going to happen all your life. You have to try to the best of your ability to convince them that, you know, this is the kind of house that there are literally millions of in the world, all over Europe, all over the US, all over, you know, certain parts of Delhi, there are so many of these houses. Why would you again want to make something that so many millions of people have? And why would you not want to make something that is yours and yours truly and is one of a kind? So sometimes you will win the battle, sometimes you will lose the battle. Then it's your call whether to go ahead with that project in the way the guy wants or not to go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely.
But you have to try to convince him. That's the best you can do. You have to try and convince him in a positive way. Saying that, you know, there are, I mean, like you're talking about glass houses, right? So you have to convince them that this is not good from the energy point of view. It's not good from you're creating a heat trap. You're going to increase your air conditioning cost lifelong. Why would you want to do that?
Absolutely.
And then
absolutely.
People should get it. There will always be a percentage who will not get it.
Yeah,
there will
absolutely.
Always be.
There will always be.
You have to try.
Absolutely. Another question was about context, understanding the context of the site and what important factors should we consider, especially in terms of medium to small scale projects.
So the most important factor is the orientation of the site as to where it is located in terms of the sun direction. Very pertinent. And especially in all the parts of India, from Delhi downwards to the south of India, where there is a lot of sun for 6 months, 35 degrees to 40 degrees Celsius. So you have to reduce the heat gain. So can you orient everything towards the north? But let's say you can't orient towards the north because the view is not good, or there's an existing building very close by. So then what do you do? Or maybe the view for your that particular plot is towards the east direction or west direction. So then you have to look at it that way. And then suppose you are oriented to the east or west, then accordingly your design will change in the sense that you need that much more sheltering, because east is going to get very harsh morning sun, west is going to get very harsh evening sun. So the parameters are climate, the immediate context and surroundings of the site, what materials are available in that region. If you're building in Rajasthan, there are so many sandstones available. If you're building in a place like Alibag or a place like Nasik, close to Bombay, there is black stone available in abundance. So you use those materials. So your material cost comes down. So these are some of the factors. So it's basically about putting the functions of the client, the climate, context of the site and its location, and the materials that you can adapt. And then at the same time, going beyond and doing something in a new way. Otherwise, there is no point of being in this field if you are simply following or repeating or copying what has been done in the past.
Absolutely. We've had one very interesting question on how do you think artificial intelligence will change architecture? I guess he's asking in terms of that virtual reality technology HP India has introduced this time.
Talking about VR, yeah. So we've also bought it. And believe me, it's amazing.
All right.
So, yes, you can sketch a place. So you kind of look, and because with more experience, you understand better that, okay, I'm going to sketch this. This is going to work out like this. Great. But if you really want to explore that, what will happen if this ceiling goes slightly higher or that window goes slightly wider? You can actually do it in a VR model. You can walk yourself through it. Till recently, about 3 months back, we were doing this large house. And when we first started, the person said that I want a house which is like 7,000 or 8,000 square feet. So we designed it accordingly. Then he said, these rooms are very small. So I said, but you know, you wanted 8 bedrooms in 8,000 square feet. So this is the kind of size you'll get. So he said, no. I want everything at least twice the size. So I said, then your area will go much higher. So he said, no, that's not a problem. You make me larger sizes. So we did all that. The house went like double the size, whatever. But he was still not understanding that, you know, what is the scale? From this point, am I going to see this garden? Am I going to see this? Will I be able to look down here? Can I see in this void? And when we made this VR model, he walked through the whole thing. He was able to understand everything the way it was. And so for a layman, it makes a huge difference. A huge difference in understanding what the space is, from where, what you can see, how you can see. And even for architects, I mean, it's a great way to actually experience and to understand what is happening, where it's happening, how it's happening. It's a great thing for a project manager, site manager. Imagine a contractor. You know, contractor sometimes, and when you, especially when you BIM model the whole thing also, so you've actually got the beams and which, you know, where the seams are, where the pipes have to go through, what all needs to be done. And that entire model can be studied in detail by a contractor. So then there is no question of mistakes. So all of these things are just making it easier. Little more complex because you have to do that much more work in the beginning. But then eventually it makes the whole life much easier for everybody concerned.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We got some really amazing insights in this live session. Yep. So should I take a couple of more questions too? Or?
Yeah.
Who's already using Grasshopper? One guy saying, you are one of the top architects. Which is your dream project? What is your dream project?
My dream project would be to build like a cultural center museum which showcases Indian art, Indian handicrafts, and the whole process in a really interesting manner, make a beautiful place, and probably or preferably in an isolated location, so that that building puts that isolated location on the map. It makes a huge difference to the economy of that place. There are a lot of small cities in India which, you know, they don't have anything to fuel their growth in a way. Like, let's see what the Bilbao Museum, the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. Nobody had heard of Bilbao. And it was that mayor who thought that, you know, let me get Guggenheim here. And they made this museum. It took them 15 or 18 years or whatever it was to make it. But the economy of the city changed. I mean, Bilbao was an industrial town. Now Bilbao is a tourist place. And people are going there. There was new everything, new hotels, new jobs. It's like this whole city being actually generated by one building. So it would be a dream to make that one building that can actually, you know, give life to a city, create that much employment, create that much, you know, just bring the whole city to life, number one. And why Indian arts? Because at the same time, it gives impetus to all the Indian arts and handicrafts that are languishing and gives them a new, you know, lease of life. That would be a dream project.
Yeah.
Ideally, somewhere in a small city in Pakistan.
in Rajasthan. All right, I have the perfect place in Haryana because I am from Karnal. It's midway between Delhi and Chandigarh. So Kurukshetra is one of the perfect places to create such kind of a project because Haryana has a very strong history, culturally also and heritage wise also. But there, you can't see that in the state. You will not see any architecture that is reflecting that whole history. There is one this huge space in Kurukshetra, but there is that story is missing that you're talking about. You know, that makes the whole city puts the city on the map, and that brings a lot of job and other opportunities in the city. So that is something missing. Yeah. All right, we had a really great conversation.
Find someone with the land there to do it.
All right, I'll let you know. Yeah, I'll let you know because I did a thesis on that. So yeah, I'll let you know if I find one.
Yeah. Another very important thing is, I done a thesis on human behavior and how it affects architecture. And a lot of people don't take all that into cognizance. Okay. Yes, simple things. Some of them are explained in this book, Form, Space and Order by Francis D.K. Ching. There's another book called Inquiry by Design, which also explains some aspects. So it's like you do a square room, completely closed, make an opening on one side, the room changes. There's a dimensional change in it. Open one whole side, there is a complete room. Open two sides. So, degrees of openness, identity, something which is repeated in mass does not allow people to come to terms with it. So it, without people realizing it, people are not that happy. And that's why, these mass housings, which are repetitive units, people do not have that sense of identity in those.
Absolutely, yeah. I think people need to, architecture should reflect the culture of a city and people should take pride in that. People should, they should be bragging about, my city has this. It has so many beautiful spaces exactly. That you can learn. Yeah, that is missing in Indian architecture. I feel that. Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. We had really great insights in this Instagram Live. Thank you so much for taking time out for this Instagram Live and enlightening us with all your great insights. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. And thank you so much, everybody, for joining us in this Instagram Live. It was really amazing.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us.
All right. Bye-bye, sir. Bye-bye.